And so next, I'll turn it over to Ken Gotch.
Thank you. John George, our audit partner, was going to step up and walk you through his brief presentation on this year's financial audit.
Thank you, everyone. My name's John George, audit partner with RSM, and Katie Ferry here with me as well. She's new manager with the firm. We've got a couple on our agenda here, just a year-end audit result. So we were back here with you in June talking about our audit plan. We've gone through since that point in time and brought us here to present the final audit results. We're going to cover real quick the audit team. We'll talk about our audit process. We'll go through some of the results and our opinion, financial highlights, required communications, and results of the grant, as well as not included here, we have foundation results for foundation. But overall, myself, the team comprises of myself, as a partner, Katie Berry, the senior manager is involved. Other team members are Katie Fair, our senior associate. Katie was here from the day-to-day operations, doing all the field work, the financial audit and compliance audit. We had Aubrey Liu, her assistant, was out here. Jessica West, who you met in our meeting in June, did the compliance audit. Jessica is now at the Lake Forest College. She is now on the private side, so she left the firm, but Jessica worked on the compliance audit component. Michelle Harady was our partner that did the quality control review, and then Dan Harker was the supervisor that worked on the information technology review. So we had him that got involved from a technology standpoint with our technology management consultant. So that was the team. Overall process, and we talked about this back in June, but significant process from the point where we started in May through here in September, a lot of communication, a lot of coordination. Planning obviously is a key part of the audit process. Internal meetings from the audit side, setting our risk assessment, setting our plan for our team and timeline, discussing areas of focus, management meetings with management with the college, again, timelines, significant changes as far as processes and areas of focus, communication with the board, all part of the planning process. Preliminary field work, we did that during the week of May 25th. We do risk assessments there, transaction cycles understanding, so focus on significant transaction cycles. Your payroll cycles, revenue, your receivables, your disbursement cycles, all those are significant transaction cycles that we obtain understandings on. And then we test control to make sure those cycles are operating as designed. We also do preliminary field work, do our federal program compliance testing. So we test the student financial aid program, test again. Final field work was the weeks from pretty much all of August, all the month of August and through the first week of September. So we're here for quite a bit of time. Our team is doing all the detailed testing, account balances at that time, substantive testing details, information that's obviously supporting the financial numbers that are presented by management, and then the substantive analytical procedures. Throughout that whole process, we have a lot of communication with management. We have status meetings weekly to make sure things are moving and progressing as we had planned. Drafting of financial statements from management back to us and changes back from us to management. And all that brought us to where we are today here. So we had a long process, but effective communication and planning helped us make sure that the process was smooth. So Katie's going to cover some financial audit results and financial highlights.
All right, so you have a lot of information from the auditors in front of you. So one of the most important things is the financial audit results. So we have a lot of audit opinions and materials that you received. All were clean, unmodified opinions. We issued audit opinions on the basic financial statements, as well as the audits of the ICC grant programs, the adult ed program improvement grants. We also issued opinions on the report on internal control over financial reporting and compliance, as well as we did an exam and issued an opinion on the report on the schedule of enrollment data and other basis. We also had a separate audit over the foundation, which is included as a component unit in the financial statements of the college.
So of the 90-page document, the financial statements and all the single audit testing and the single audit reports, all that information is really management's and the college information, and the auditor's component is really opinion. So our opinions that we issue were the highest level of opinions we can issue, unmodified opinions, meaning we didn't have any issues with the financial information that management presented.
All right, so next slide. So the next slide is just a snapshot of the operating funds. So the operating funds consist of the education and the O&M funds. So just to go through this screen, so the total revenues compared to last year increased by 4.7%, or about $4.5 million. And the most notable increases for that were about $1.2 million in tuition and fees, about $1.2 million increase in the ICCB credit hour grant, as well as an increase in the property taxes. So those three components were the most significant portion of that increase over last year. When it comes to the total expenditures, you can see that there's actually a decrease last year. So that's a factor of not fulfilling some vacant positions that were out there and overall kind of containing the cost of the college. So overall, the operating income for the operating funds was $11.6 million. And one thing to point out is that does not factor in some of the revenue that the state did not pass the budget until July 7th. So the stance that GASB took, since the state of Illinois was not going to recognize a liability, all of the community colleges and other governments that were owed that money weren't going to reflect the receivable and therefore the corresponding revenue. So within these financial statements, there's $6.6 million that was not reflected as revenue, which will now be recognized in fiscal year 18.
So a key component here, you know, state of Illinois, uncertainty with the state and funding situation. So I guess the key message and what you're focused on as management from a budgetary standpoint is sustainability. Financial sustainability in this questioning time with the state of Illinois funding process, making sure that we have the resources available to continue on, right, to operate effectively.
Okay, so then the next slide that we have are just some ratios over the operating funds. So when you look at the months of expenditures and transfers that are in the fund balance, in 2017, that was 4.9, an increase of from 3.9 from last year. The next ratio is the fund balance as a percentage of expenditures and transfers. That for 2017, we're at 41%. As far as the net change as a percentage of the fund balance is 21.2%. The next slide that we have, the financial highlights over the auxiliary fund. So that's bookstore, food services, student activities, athletics, performing arts, things to that extent. So when it comes to this fund, there's both a decrease in the revenues and the expenditures. And the main factor for that is overall a decrease in enrollment. And then the next slide that we have is a snapshot of the overall net position. That's all of the funds that the college has. So in addition to the O&M, it's including the O&M restricted, the capital projects, debt service, working cash, it's including all of the funds. And what this is a breakdown of three components of net position. The net investment in capital assets, so that's taking all of the capital assets that the college has and reducing any outstanding bonds. So with all of the construction that's going on around campus, there's an increase from $93 million last year to about $110 million this year. The unrestricted was a decrease. It's at $92.3 million. That's funds that's available for spending to cover those expenditures that the college has on an annual basis. So overall, the total net position, we're at $205.8 million, which is an increase of about $9.6 million from last year.
So we just pulled out a couple highlights from the operating fund, but out of that 92-page report, I think a couple key spots to look at, get some good information on, so we're going to read the whole 92-page report. Management discussion analysis is a nice recap of financial information from this year compared to last year, some good highlights on what we're covering, revenue, expense changes, budgetary plans. All those are listed out from one year of comparison to the next on the management discussion analysis. And then the transmittal note. The college issues a comprehensive financial report for a certificate of excellence in financial reporting with the Finance Officers Association. So that certificate is going to be submitted again this year. The report will be submitted again for the certificate. So there's a lot of work that goes into preparation of these statements of management, both from the transmittal letter, the supplemental schedules. There's a lot of detailed information in there. The transmittal letter is one of the most important components that we see in the report. So those two letters, management discussion analysis and Attorney's Bill letter, are good recaps to pull together that 92-page synopsis. Required communication. So part of our auditing standards require that, statement of our auditing standards 114, require that we communicate certain points to the board. We issue that letter, there's a draft of that letter, covers changes in accounting policies or any significant issues or difficulties that arose during the course of the audit. We didn't have any significant issues encountered. There were no changes in accounting policies. So really, as you go through that letter, there's not a lot of changes there, but we did list out, we have to report if there's any audit adjustments. We did have 3 audit adjustments this year. Prior year, we had 2. Those audit adjustments related to year-end closeout of construction in progress and changes. And internal control points, inherently, when you have an audit adjustment translates into an internal control point. So at the lowest level, control deficiency, we didn't have any control deficiencies. We had 4 last year, and all 4 of those control deficiencies were rectified and responded by management. We didn't have those repeat this year. There were no material weaknesses. As a control deficiency rises, it rises to a significant deficiency and then material weakness. No material weaknesses, there were none last year. We did have 1 significant deficiency this year that related to construction in progress points, the journal entries that we had. And we'll talk a little bit more about that as we get into the single audit report. Either way, management has addressed it. It's been proactive in addressing the points and has a correct follow-up plan to address it. Compliance reports. We also issue a report in accordance with government auditing standards and informed grant guidance on the federal expenditures, federal awards. We tested the student financial aid. We issued an unmodified clean opinion on that as well. We did have 1 compliance finding that we noted. There were 2 students, 2 out of 40 that we tested, that did not have their enrollment status sent into the clearinghouse. From a compliance standpoint, we have to report compliance finding. That's not a material compliance finding. No impact to from a question and cost standpoint, and not an internal control issue. A compliance finding nonetheless, we have to report it. And management has responded with a corrective action plan. Information Technology Services has created a program that will address this and alleviate it going forward. So again, not a significant point, but something that we do. Under the government auditing standards, we do disclose in the single audit report the audit adjustments that are related to construction progress. Again, communication process between internal and external resources of information, year-end cutoff, year-end construction progress and changes. And management, again, has put together a plan for addressing those issues. Last point is the College Foundation, Council of County Foundation audit. Again, unmodified opinion on the foundation. The foundation report is included as a component unit within the college's report. We did have 1 control deficiency here, and it's at the lowest level of deficiencies and related to support for a non-cash donation. The process should be that there's evaluation paid for those non-cash donations. It just wasn't contained. There was support that was provided later, but the original support was no significant audit issues, for difficulties in the process of the foundation audit, but we will be having a separate presentation of foundation's finance audit reports. Overall, from May through September, a long process, a very large audit. Very thankful to all the work that management and the finance team has put into to get it to this point. There's obviously a lot of work that goes into this document, a lot of work that goes into the 6 weeks of final field work and preliminary field work and all the testing we do. So very responsive to our requests, great communication between the firm and management to help us get to start and finish to where we are today. So appreciate that. Questions?
Any questions? Catherine?
Yes, I have several, and I've addressed them already with a few of our staff members, so I appreciate your time before the board meeting. I did read the 92 pages and the other letters you sent us, even though we had a short turnaround time. And I just have a couple of framing questions for my own frame of reference. This is my first pass through a community college auditing process. I was alarmed at the non-material issues. For me to have any issue in an audit, is something to take note of. So I sent information to our admin team with that frame of mind, which I understand is a little different than a community college. So I just want to get your point of view as our auditor. So I understand the two concerns, or I'm not, give me the right language to use. I know they're not concerns, but yeah, they're not significant. But the issues related to the student financial aid that our staff consulted with the National Clearing House, and they were misdirected, and therefore that was one of your findings, correct? Right. And I also understand, my follow-up question was, is this common with other community colleges, sort of a common gap occurring this year?
A specific issue.
Right, with the clearinghouse issue, that's kind of giving misdirections.
I mean, when you're testing student financial aid, compliance finders, there's a lot of testing involved, a lot of compliance requirements. So we're looking at a lot of student files, a lot of student records. So compliance findings are common. This specific compliance issue, I can't say that we've had it at another client in this current year, but compliance findings and non-material compliance findings are fine. Whenever, when we're doing any tests of walk-in transaction tests from a standard state compliance or control, we have to report that as either at the lowest level of control efficiency or the lowest level of compliance. So the control deficiencies aren't required to be are required to be communicated, but not required to be put away. So we don't have any, and it's management's preference whether or not we put it away. We don't have any control deficiencies, but compliance findings are required to be.
No, I appreciate that. That causes us to engage in a different level of oversight, which is important to me as a board member.
Sure.
And then moving on into the construction area that you mentioned lightly, I've also chatted with staff about that piece. And my question to you as auditor is, do you think there's any other sort of oversight we should be engaging in as we look forward? Are there any other measures we should be doing? I'm aware of what your audit report says. And the non-material findings, but it just gave me a pause and made me just step back and wonder, is there anything else we should be doing as a college?
There's a large volume of construction that's going on. This is clearly a cutoff issue, reporting from the external into the internal review process. So it's really just that communication of focus on that cutoff. Throughout the year, we had no issues with any of the testing we did throughout the year and any of the construction additions or transactions throughout the year. It's really just that year-end cutoff close out for those contractors. So outside of what management's already addressed, the improving that communication focus on those contractor statements, that's why it didn't rise to a material weakness. There's a plan in place, and it's something that would repeat again in the future based on the plan and management's goal.
So neither of these two areas then were anything that requires you to think we need to take a deeper dive? From an audit point of view?
No.
And 2 out of 40 students being monitored having some non-material questions, is that a normal ratio? Is that high? What do you see at other schools?
It's hard to say when it's a compliance, when it's a compliance finding. It's a finding. So it could be 1 out of 40, it could be 2 out of 40. Maybe 2 out of 40 was not an alarming issue, right? But it identified that there's that issue of communication with the clearinghouse, so from our perspective, it wasn't a concern that there was a real breakdown in internal control. It was information that was provided to staff that created the issue, right? So from the clearinghouse, it doesn't alleviate the problem, but so from a compliance standpoint, it wasn't a significant issue that would be a material issue in that compliance.
That's great. Then I just had one misunderstanding fact related from slide 6, just a really quick question. We talked about the fund balance, percentage of expenditures, and that change of percentage this year, 21.2. Could you just give me a 60-second explanation of that, please?
Sure. So that 21.2% is, let me see here. That is, I believe that is the increase, I believe that's the increase from last year. I don't have my calculator with me. from last year's ending fund balance to this year's ending fund balance.
Right, that's what it says up there. I'm just wondering what factors would cause a 21% swing.
So it's a combination of, so it would be a combination of the increases in the revenues that we talked about, and then the...
So it's a net, it's a net 7 million. It's 11.6 less the transfer to 4.9 compared to the 31 million. So that's a 21%. So the factors that Katie mentioned, the increase in the revenues and the decrease in expenses, all of the drivers in that 21%.
That makes sense.
But that 21% would have been higher if you were out the state money in time before the 2018 budget.
Any questions?
Any other questions?
Nice job.
Yes, nice job.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Nice to see you, John. I know we talked on the phone.
Yes, yeah. Nice to see you too.
I want to thank the staff for all their work. I know that the audit is a heavy lift and they do good work with it. And, you know, one of the reasons that you see the finances the way they are and the good shape that they are is the good work that folks across the college do to hold down costs. We're going to continue to spend some time talking about that as we talk with the board. We're going to continue to be conservative. But this was really good news because folks have really been looking at expenditures. We've held positions down. We've held other expenditures down as well. So this is really the result of folks across the campus being very conservative in how we approach given some of the financial uncertainties.